Vikrant sailing out into the Arabian Sea for the first time, her maiden sea sortie. For thousands of men and women involved in her design and construction, this would be the moment of truth. Would the months of planning that led up to this day be worth it? Would Vikrant be able to cope up with the monsoon conditions? Sea State 4 with waves rising above 13 feet. Would her hull, engines, power generation systems, and thousands of subsystems and auxiliary equipment work the way that they were designed? For 5 days, the aircraft carrier, the first to be made in India, was put through her paces. After tracking the project to build an Indian aircraft carrier for 17 years, we had this opportunity to get a first-hand idea of how it all went.
Hello and welcome to a very special program. We are on board Vikrant, India's first indigenously built aircraft carrier. It's also called ISE-1. It'll be called INS Vikrant once it commissions into the Navy in a short period of time. Vikrant was, of course, India's first aircraft carrier that went into war in 1971. But unlike that Vikrant, this has been entirely built at home. It's an Indian aircraft carrier built to an Indian design, 76% indigenization, in a sense a real model of how Atmanirbhar Bharat works. When it's ready, in all respects, it'll have a complement of 24 plus fighter jets to start with, MiG-29K fighters and multi-role helicopters as well, with the goal of this warship being to dominate a carrier battle group in the Indian Ocean region. This comes with an eye on China and its increasingly resurgent Navy.
Back from trials, Vikrant lay docked at the Kochi shipyard, her home. This is where we had a chance of checking her out firsthand. Commodore Vidyadhar Harke is Vikrant's designated captain. He has the awesome responsibility of seeing her through her commissioning sometime next year. To get the opportunity to command Vikrant, he says, is a dream.
Well, Vishnu, at the outset, I would like to welcome you on board this indigenous ship that we are constructing. And as you said, how the feeling is, it's nothing but exhilarating. Why? It's a dream for any ex-officer of Indian Navy to command a ship. And that to a carrier, it's like out of and that to commissioning is, as I said, adrenaline rush, 24/7.
How were the sea trials? I believe you went out in Sea State 4 and really pushed the brand new ship.
Well, we had set out on undertaking certain parameter checks, put the ship through the paces, check how the machinery functions in varying conditions, how do the auxiliaries fetch up to the demand of power requirements, and it was a longish sortie. Now what set it apart is, while we undertook it in paces, but as we kept on exploiting the engines, as we kept on exploiting the machinery, we realized that we have capability to go up and up, and we achieved maximum full power trial, and that's what sets it apart.
With a fully loaded displacement of 45,000 tons, Vikrant is the largest warship to be built in India by far. She's 262 meters long, 62 meters at the widest part, and has a height of 59 meters, including the superstructure, or what's known as the island of the carrier that you see here. There are 14 decks in all, including 5 in the superstructure. Vikrant has over 2,300 compartments designed for a crew of around 1,700 people. She will eventually embark 40 aircraft, including MiG-29K fighters that you see here operating on INS Vikramaditya, the other aircraft carrier that India operates. Vikrant will also operate Kamov 31 airborne early warning helicopters, among other choppers. While fighting a naval battle is what Vikrant is designed to do, she is in fact a floating city. To cater to 1,700 people on board while supplying power to a system, power generation is key. Modern warships are hungry for electricity, and Vikrant is no different. In fact, Vikrant is a full-fledged power plant.
Where we stand is called as the turbine control room. From here, we have got the IPMS. The full form is Integrated Platform Management System, where we use this system to control the ship's main propulsion machinery, that is the engines and the power generating equipment, the diesel alternators and the auxiliary equipment like the air conditioning plants, the refrigeration plants, the compressors and the pumps which supply us the fireman pressure, etc.
This is an interesting point because this is like a city and this is the control room of the electric generation plant. Would that be appropriate?
That's right. Yeah, not only electric generation, we control the propulsion power which propels the ship also.
And to give us an idea, how much power or electricity
that it can
it has enough of power to power up a city.
The Vikrant was built to a design made by Indian naval engineers. This was not a foreign design, let alone a ship that was imported. Yes, there were foreign consultants and studies, but that was to reinforce a vision that the Indian Navy had of the ship that they wanted. And this has meant greater accountability. It was not easy. Early design plans went through several iterations. Specific designs were rejected, new ones adopted, and the process of integrating it all, it was clear from the onset, was going to be an incredible challenge.
The awesome task of actually getting the IAC out to sea in an operational state and even in the trial process is up to the superintendent who looks after the entire process over here. We are very privileged to be joined by Commodore Ganpati. Thanks, sir, very much for being with us. Your first thoughts when you finally saw IAC-1 Vikrant sail out for a sea trials after all these years?
I would say that it is the fruition of the cumulative efforts of a few generations who have put in, starting from the late 80s when it was conceptualized. And to see her actually sail in the first sortie, sustaining herself at sea, meeting almost all the mission parameters per se, is highly satisfying.
You're an engineer yourself, right?
That's correct.
So as an engineer, and speaking as an engineer, to see all the parts of the ship, all the components, all the high tech, all the low tech come together and function the way it's supposed to, what was that for you as somebody supervising all of the engineering?
I must say it is highly satisfying, you know. It was more of nirvana being attained because when I'm looking at the aircraft carrier and I'm carrying 1,200 people on board and I'm carrying six ladies with me, technicians, I have my entire galley working, the sanitation system, my water generation, which are primarily required to ensure that I'm able to sustain at sea, you know. These are things generally people don't talk about, but without that, I can't fight. So having looked at that and we sailed out during monsoons, which is again something very different, and having achieved the speeds which are required as per design, sustaining them for the right kind of time without any particular issues as such, goes to show the kind of work which has gone in and also the kind of quality of work which has gone in.
At the heart of Vikrant lies its engine room. Propulsion comes from four US-sourced Lockheed Martin LM2500 gas turbine engines. These can take Vikrant to a top speed of more than 25 knots or nearly 50 kilometers per hour. In the busy engine room of Vikrant, a host of Navy engineers work day in and out to ensure that the turbines are working optimally. Vikrant is brand new. Teething issues have to be spotted early and fixed early. The entire process of running these engines is through a high level of automation.
This is the engine room of the Vikrant. It's these gas turbines that give the ship its power. It is these gas turbines that actually enable the production of electricity to generate all functions on board the ship. These are many of the crew and the engineers actually involved in this particular space. So what exactly do you do over here that is so important to Vikrant operating at sea?
The place where we are standing is the heart of the ship. It's one of the engine rooms on board. We have got our propulsion package, which consists of LM2500 gas turbines. So you can say this is the place which packs the punch for our aircraft carrier.
Yeah. And what is the goal? When you're out at sea, you're in an operation, maintaining the efficiency of this unit. Maintaining the efficiency of this unit is obviously your top priority, right? So what is that goal? Tell us about that challenge.
So as we move on to the 21st century, we need new breed of ships. We need new breed of technology. And this Vikrant is the pinnacle of automation. That's the goal that we are aiming at, to have a fully automation system and to have an automated system and to achieve with the greater heights, which can ensure sustenance and capability to deliver what the ship actually is capable of farther from the sovereign lands, so as to truly become a blue water navy.
For the Indian Navy, aircraft carrier operations lie at the heart of their operational doctrine. There are no naval platforms which can dominate hundreds of square kilometers of the ocean in quite the same manner. For decades, the Navy operated this aircraft carrier, the Virat, and earlier, the Vikrant, which saw action in 1971. The new Vikrant has been named after India's first aircraft carrier that went to war in 1971. When the new aircraft carrier goes to sea on a mission, she will not be alone. Escorting her is her carrier battle group, destroyers, frigates, and a submarine. The Indian Navy is clear. A Chinese carrier battle group can be deployed in the Indian Ocean region at any time. China operates two aircraft carriers presently, with a third, substantially larger warship being constructed. There is no country on earth that builds and deploys warships at the rate China does. And in order to match this, India, the Navy says, needs three aircraft carriers, with at least two fully operational at any stage. But this does not come cheap. Vikrant has cost 23,000 crores to build. A larger carrier will be substantially more expensive.
The costs making an aircraft carrier or any other platform, weapon platform, will always be there. I think what balances this out is the fact that it is made in India. And so most of the investment, I don't call it a cost, I call it an investment that is being done, is being plowed back into our industries, public and private sector. As I mentioned, over 50 OEMs took part in this, public and private sector. But when you look even closer, the number of ancillary industries, you know, people, for example, if you're making a compressor and you have to have, copper wire for that, that is made by somebody else. Nuts and bolts, washers, yeah, are made by somebody else. This has supported the employment of over 40,000 Indians over the past few years. Even today, 2,000 workers a day work on this. It spawns a host of service industries. It supports directly and indirectly many more people.
Sure.
So the investment that it does also produces technology, which can then be used for other applications.
Yeah.
And that in turn enhances our indigenous capability as well. I think it also demonstrates to the world that we have this very potent shipbuilding capability, and that if we scale it up in future, we can export many more warships than we do today.
Yeah.
And many more weapon systems.
Yeah.
So all in all, I think it's a testament to the coming of age of the Indian defense industry.
When she is ready in all respects, Vikrant will be a floating airfield. All flight operations will be directed from here. The Flyco, or the flying control position. This Flyco is larger than those in many other aircraft carriers and gives officers here a commanding view of the flight deck of the ship. MiG-29K fighters will eventually trap on the deck of Vikrant. And this is what you see here on INS Vikramaditya, the Indian Navy's only operational aircraft carrier, which was acquired from Russia. It's a delicate art, the fighter jets lining up with the tiny deck of the carrier. A fighter deploys a tiny hook and slams down onto the deck of the carrier, with the tail hook catching one of three arrestor wires which lie across the deck of the ship. Eventually, though, the Indian Navy would want an evolution of this aircraft, the Naval Tejas testbed, to be its fighter of choice for the future. Tested on board the INS Vikramaditya, the Navy is looking closely at a twin-engine variant of this fighter, but that is still years away. Deep inside Vikrant, Commander Davinder Singh Grover, a senior engineering officer, watches closely over Vikrant's ship's control system.
Well, we're now at the ship's control center of IAC-1, or Vikrant, which will soon be INS Vikrant once it's commissioned. The senior engineering officer over here will tell us a little bit about what this room does. Thanks very much for being with us. You were telling me some interesting points a little while earlier on. What exactly do you do it over here in all of these panels and all of these posts which are manned?
Yeah. So as you've said, this is the ship's control center, and as the name suggests, this is the control center for the ship and the ship's machinery, the ship's propulsion systems, the ship's power generation systems. We have a lot of multifunction consoles here that are responsible for controlling the aforesaid systems. There is a high degree of automation in this ship, and so much to say that you can probably control all the equipments that are there in the ship at the touch of a button. Soft click on these MFCs.
And I think the interesting point is this has been made to an Indian design, to a Navy design. So it's what you actually wanted. It's not what you bought from outside.
Absolutely. The IPMS, that is the heart and soul of these automation systems, has been made in India by our own PSUs, that is BHEL, and they have been customized for the requirements of the Indian Navy and especially an aircraft carrier. Since the carrier is huge and we have voluminous systems running through the ship, the requirement for command and control increases that much. So that is why the number of MFCs and the number of people manning this place round the clock is also far more than what you would see in a conventional warship.
While the Navy operates the Vikrant, actually building the ship was a massive challenge for Cochin Shipyard. Very few countries build their own aircraft carriers. After the US, the UK, France, Italy, China, Russia and Spain, India is the eighth nation to be able to do this. Building the first ship is always the toughest.
Cochin Shipyard has been building commercial ships. We follow something called an IHOP system. It's called Integrated Hull Outfitting and Painting. So a lot of outfitting happens in the block stage itself. For this particular ship, it was not done that way. It was an evolving design. We normally do the design first and we start constructing the ship later. Here in this case, it was just not possible. The design was happening, simultaneously the construction was also happening. So that way it was very challenging. It's a totally different methodology that CSL was adopting. But in all defense projects, especially for the maiden ship, we can follow only this concept of probably doing the design as well as the construction together.
For now, the first goal of sailing out the aircraft carrier and proving the capability of our hull has been achieved, but there's still a lot of work left. The Navy will fit Vikrant with a variety of Israeli MF Star radars that equip their latest generation destroyers, and the carrier will be armed with 64 Barak 8 medium-range surface-to-air missiles. These are defensive weapon systems meant to intercept enemy missiles or aircraft that manage to pierce the carrier's fighter jet defenses. For now, Commodore Harke is busy, not just supervising the engineering aspects of Vikrant, but being a friend and a mentor to the 1,000+ men under his command.
The crew is highly motivated. For one, being the part of commissioning crew itself is a big boost of them. Other, this being the first indigenous aircraft carrier itself sets them apart. Well, close interaction, man-to-man communication, and motivating at each level of work goes unsaid. And well, it comes as a part and parcel. It's said that a good captain walks his ship and interacts with his men and of course subsequently women officers at their workplace.
Right.
So to know there what ailing them, what is troubling them, or what is keeping them going on despite all the odds, probably family separation, difficult living condition, or asking them to do more than probably normal call of duty, which many a time happens. So that's what a commanding officer is expected to do, and I'll live by the legacy what my predecessors have taught us to do.
Vikrant will now be prepared for her next set of trials that will be in a few months from now. There is still work to be done before she is commissioned. The interior of the ship needs to be finished. Several components, including equipment for air operations, will be installed now before the first fighter jet trials take place. It's taken over a decade to get to this stage, but Vikrant will be sailing for another 50 years at the center of the Indian Navy's plans to dominate India's areas of maritime interest. She's not just a symbol of India, she's among the country's most powerful military assets ever conceived or built in this nation. With Manu Nair, Vishnu Shon for NDTV.